Hello, I am Bob, and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining Channel. In this build series episode, I'm going to start the build of my 120-volt Bitcoin miner. So with that, let's get started. But before starting with the build, I want to mention some sponsors of the channel, starting with Brains and their Brains Toolbox app. Now, for those of you with only a single miner, you can log directly into the Brains OS Plus firmware to manage your miner operation. But once you expand your mining operation to more than just one miner, logging into each miner separately is a real pain. And this is where the Brains Toolbox app comes in. The Brains Toolbox app is a free downloadable miner management tool that gives you a single interface to manage all of your miners. It works with miners running stock Bitmain firmware, as well as with miners running the Brains OS Plus firmware. From this app, you can do everything you need to manage your devices. You can install or upgrade your miner firmware, remotely locate or reboot your miner, start and stop mining, configure your mining pool, and adjust your auto-tuning and dynamic performance scaling settings. You can make these updates one miner at a time or organize your miners into groups so that you can do any of these operations across whole batches of your mining farm. The app has an awesome graphical user interface, but if you are a power user and want to develop scripting or utilize the tool's more advanced capabilities, there is a complete command line interface that gives you full functionality of the tool. And so, whether you're running two miners or 2,000 miners, the Brains Toolbox app is an essential tool to running your mining operation. Now, my next sponsor is Scott's Crypto Mining and the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp. In the Build-A-Mine Bootcamp, you'll learn everything you need to know to launch your first megawatt of Bitcoin miners in less than 3 months. The Build-A-Mine Bootcamp is taught by Scott himself, and you'll be joined by other entrepreneurs and business owners like you who want to learn how to stack more sats faster through Bitcoin mining on an industrial scale. To get in on this fantastic opportunity, just click the link in the description below. And last up is a brand new sponsor of the channel, Altair Bitcoin Mining Solutions, which is a perfect match for home mining. Altair is your one-stop shop for any mining hardware you might need. They have everything from the latest and greatest miners to every hashboard, cable, and part you might need to repair your existing hardware or build your own 120-volt home-built miner. Altair has years of experience working in the Bitcoin mining industry, including running their own Bitcoin farm, and they've worked with all different scales of mining operations. Altair is based in the U.S. and has top-rated customer support. And so if you have any question about anything at any time, they are there to help you out. Altair is a huge supporter of the home mining community. So if you're looking to buy your next miner or miner parts for your home setup, check out their website at the link below. You'll find pretty much everything you'll ever need. Okay, so in the last episode, I covered the start of my budget immersion mining build. The goal of this build is a single miner system that is budget conscious, built mostly of easily obtainable off-the-shelf hardware, and can be powered by conventional 120-volt power. I have a link above to that video where I covered the first steps of designing and building the immersion tank and dielectric fluid pump. Now, when it comes to the miner, with the limitation of 120-volt power, a normal state-of-the-art Bitmain miner isn't going to work. They run on high current 120-volt power, so I decided to build my own 120-volt immersion miner. I talked through my idea with my new sponsor, Altair Mining Solutions, who stepped up and provided me with all of the hardware needed to put this new miner together. I also heavily used the information provided by the folks at Pivotal Pleb Tech, who have done a ton of pioneering work with building 120-volt miners. I have a link below to their website. They are a great resource to anyone looking to build a 120-volt machine. And the first step in designing my 120-volt miner is tackling power. I need to replace the 240-volt power supply unit, or PSU, that normally powers Bitmain S19 miners. Now, the PSU provides DC power to all the other components of the miner. Most of this power goes to the three hashboards where Bitcoin mining hashes are calculated, but a small amount of that power goes to the control board. This control board, in turn, uses that power to control the overall operation of the miner, including controlling the hashboards, telling the PSU how much power to send to the hashboards, and sending power to the four large fans that cool the miner. Now, for an immersion setup, the four large fans aren't needed, but they really don't use that much power, so eliminating them really doesn't do much to fix my 240-volt power problem. To run on only 120 volts, I have to reduce the power needed by the miner from the normal 3,000 plus watts down to under 1,500 watts, which is about the maximum amount of power you can pull from a single 120-volt home power circuit. And the only way of getting there is to greatly reduce the amount of hashing calculations done by the miner. Now, there are a couple different methods to reduce miner hash power. The first is to take a stock miner and just run the hashboards at much lower power levels. Altair has their Erlacher model, which does exactly that. It's based on the Bitmain S19K Pro, and if you're looking for a no-hassle, out-of-the-box 120-volt miner, it's a fantastic option. The other method of reducing hash power, and the path that I'm taking, is to just eliminate two of the three hashboards. Hashboards also make up the largest cost of a miner, so with a budget focus, this seemed like the cheapest option when building my 120-volt miner from scratch. With only one hashboard, I can use a much smaller and cheaper power supply than the stock S19-style 240-volt PSU. And one of the best options here is a Bitmain APW3++ power supply. These were built to power the older S9 series of miners, and so there are literally thousands of used APW3s on the market. Altair sells these for as low as $65, and as S9s become less and less economical to use, the price will likely drop from here. Now, the downsides of using the APW3 is that they were made to work with the S9 miners, and so the voltage output levels and cabling aren't quite right and need a little modification to work here. The guys at Pivotal Pleb Tech have a great step-by-step guide for doing this upgrade, which I'm going to follow. But before stepping through that upgrade, I want to point out that this is dangerous work. These power supplies are old and used, and we really don't have any idea of what they've been through. In addition, doing this mod means working around high power capacitors, which can contain lethal power levels even after the power supply has been unplugged for long periods of time. To quote the guide, "The power supply you are working on contains capacitors that store high levels of electrical energy that can be extremely dangerous or deadly, even when disconnected from the power source. Extreme caution must be exercised when modifying the power supply." The guide also lists additional safety precautions that I followed in my work. And if you're attempting this update, you need to read the guide and follow those precautions as well. So treat everything here as a simple show and tell of how I built my power supply. And if after hearing and reading all of these warnings, and after watching me modify my hardware, you have any doubts about your qualifications or your abilities to make these modifications, don't do it. Because with Altair, you don't have to. Altair sells an already modified version of the APW3 power supply. They've done all of the dangerous work for you. You can just order it and be done. But I wanted to show you the details of how I modified my power supply, so here it is. Okay, so the first step is to unbox and unbag the power supply. Off camera, I did plug in the power supply and check the voltage to make sure I was working with good hardware. To start the teardown, I removed the three screws from each side of the miner. The cover and plastic insulation shield came off easily. Next, I removed the four large screws holding the fan and fan guard in place. And in this view, you can see my power supply had a ton of white goop that was poured all over the board. This is a liquid insulative coating poured onto the board when it was manufactured, and the amount used in each power supply can vary quite a bit. And unfortunately, my APW3 had a ton of coating poured over everything. This made the next step of freeing the fan wire a little tricky. I had to use a pair of pliers to pull it free, being careful not to rip the wire out. The insulation was also covering the fan connector, so I had to use a knife to cut away some insulation before I could pull the connector free and remove the fan. Next up was to remove the five screws holding the board to the metal housing. Again, the white insulation got in the way here. I had to use the images in the guide and some guesswork to find some of the screws and remove them. With the board screws removed, the next step was to pull the board and plastic away from the housing. Once free, I then removed the plastic shielding away from the board. The guide doesn't tell you to do this, but I found it really helps with subsequent steps. Unfortunately, I used a little too much force and ripped the plastic. It might have been a better idea to use a knife and cut it free first. After removing the plastic, I took a razor blade and scraped off the insulation from the plastic. This isn't in the guide, but I found it helped with reinstall later. The next step is to do the board modification itself. Following the guide, I broke off the blue potentiometer, cleaned up the solder pads, and soldered in a new resistor. Again, if you're not qualified or comfortable doing this type of work, just buy the modified APW3 from Altair. Now, the type of resistor installed here will determine what voltage the power supply will operate at. There's a handy table at the end of the guide providing information about which resistor to install, and this is where things can get really complicated. There is a complex relationship between the hash port voltage, ASIC chip frequency, power use, and efficiency, which can change with different hash port types. The guys at Altair and Pivotal Pleb Tech have a lot of experience with this, and so I used a 3.3 kiloohm resistor recommended and provided by Altair. With the new resistor in place, I followed the guide to reverse the disassembly steps and rebuild the power supply. The first step was to wrap the plastic shielding around the board and put the assembly back in place. This was a little tricky. The thread bosses extending up from the bottom of the power supply housing can catch the board, but with a little force, I was able to get things back in place. Next, I inserted the 5 screws to attach the board. And next up was reinstalling the fan wire and connector, and then the 4 screws holding the fan and fan guard in place. Now, before I put the cover back on, I wanted to check the voltage to ensure everything was working. Without the cover on, the airflow through the power supply isn't great, and there are exposed high voltage electronics, so it might have been a better idea to wait to do this until the cover was on, but the voltage was 13.8 volts, which was about right, so I reinstalled the cover using the 6 screws to complete the build. With the power supply ready to go, the next step was to build a wire harness to connect my modified APW3 to my control board and my single hash board. Now, there are 2 options here. The first option is to buy a pre-made harness from Altair or another battery cable source, such as batterycableusa.com. If you go this route, you'll want to get a copper cable at least 2 wire gauge in size. You'll also need to add additional wiring connections to supply power to the control board. The other option, which is described in another one of Pivotal Pleb Tech's guides, is to modify the existing S9 wiring harness that came with the APW3 power supply. Again, I'm going for a budget design, so I decided to take this route since it reuses the old power supply wiring. Now, I couldn't follow the Pivotal Pleb Tech's guide exactly step by step here. I had to depart a bit from the document to build the harness to fit my immersion miner setup. Also, as I've stated previously, if you don't have experience with this type of work, don't do it. Just buy a pre-built copper cable from Altair or other sources. And my first step was to remove the existing power harness from the power supply using a hex wrench. You'll see that I have the cover removed. I took the cover off so I could remove the fan. I'm using this in an immersion setup, so the fan isn't needed, and the screws were just easier to access with the cover off. Once detached, I removed all of the shrink wrap and zip ties holding the wires together. Next, I cut off the old S9 plastic connectors. I left a single connector attached, and this connector will be used to power my control board. I separated and then rebundled the wires into black and yellow for ground and positive connections. I zip-tied them together to keep things organized, and you'll notice I separated the control board power connector and a single yellow and single black wire from the rest. These single wires will be used to power my Wi-Fi repeater. Now, following the guide, I had to reassemble this bundle of wires into four spade connectors, which will connect to the hashboard power bus bars. This means combining 6 to 7 wires per each connector, and this part was a bit tricky. I tried a few different techniques before I found something that worked repeatably and reliably, and the way I got this done was to first group the wires together and cut them to matching lengths. Next, I stripped back the insulation from each wire to about 1 inch from the end of the wires. I then aligned and twisted the group of wires together, and then I used a wire cutters to trim back the twisted wires to make for a clean ending for the spade connector. I could then twist on the spade connector and crimp it in place. Following the guide, I checked for any loose wires. The next step was to add a 12-volt connector to the two free wires. I cut a 12-volt connector off of an old 12-volt DC power supply and stripped and connected the wires. I used a meter to make sure I connected the correct wires to the black and yellow wires. Now, this step is only necessary because I want to connect a Wi-Fi repeater to my miner. If I was directly connecting the miner to an Ethernet cable, I would just group this wire in with the rest of the power cable. And here is the completed wiring harness. I have 4 positive and 4 negative connections, a connector for the power supply, and a connector to power the Wi-Fi repeater. And so, with the 120-volt power supply and wiring harness both completed, the next step is to put it all together. But this video is getting a bit long, so I'll be finishing my 120-volt miner build in the next episode. And if you've liked the build so far and want to see the completion of my budget home immersion miner build, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss any new episodes coming your way. And so with that, bye.